Good afternoon, we'll start the next part, that is H.261 and H.263. In the last lecture, we have studied about how to find out the motion vector, okay? And in that, we have studied three different techniques. One is sequential search of motion vector, second one is logarithmic, and the last one is hierarchical method for motion vector search, okay? Now, we'll start the next part of this one. So, particularly for what purpose these motion vectors are searched? Why we have studied this motion vector search technique? Okay. Now, see that here, the basic thing of video compression is, since video stream has two spatial coordinates and one temporal coordinate dimension, okay. So, two spatial dimension and one temporal dimension, and video compression is usually done independently in spatial dimension and temporal dimension, okay. So, what is the meaning of this one? See, your video sequence is a how many dimensions signal? Three dimension. Out of that, suppose this is x dimension, this is y dimension, okay, and this is time dimension. So, this x and y, these are which dimensions? Spatial dimension, okay, and then this t is a time dimension. Now, video compression is done independently in spatial dimension and in temporal dimension, okay. So, for doing the spatial dimension compression, we use standard JPEG, okay. Whereas, for temporal dimension compression, okay, we need to find out the change, we need to find out the motion, and by using this motion vector search technique, okay, first we are finding that motion, and then after that we are doing the compression of that motion vectors, okay. So, in spatial dimension, compression tries to eliminate the spatial redundancy, that is like JPEG, okay. And in the time dimension, compression tries to eliminate temporal redundancy, that is the motion of the object, okay. Now, already we have studied the spatial dimension compression technique, that is JPEG. Okay, so in JPEG, what we do? We divide the whole image into 8x8 non-overlapping blocks, and then each block we take the transform, okay, do the quantization of that one, then encode and so on. So, each block is processed separately, whereas in the temporal encoder, typically see when we say we have studied this motion vector search, okay. And in that motion vector search, what we have done? First thing is that you have divided that frame into macro block, n by n macro block, and the size of each macro block is 16 by 16. So, the temporal encoder typically works on a 16 by 16 pixel image or block, whereas the spatial encoder typically works on the 8 by 8. So, that is the one difference, okay. Now, motion estimation or compensation is used for the temporal encoder, okay. That is, motion estimation unit create motion vectors for each 16 by 16 block. For each macro block, you are finding the motion vector, okay. So, there are three types of frames in video, okay, or basically in this standard, we have defined three types of frames. One is I frame. I is the name based on intra. Okay, one is the, see, there is a sequence of frame like this frame, then next frame, okay, and so on, okay. So, first frame is considered as I frame, okay. Second one is P frame, then again I frame will be there, okay. Then again I frame will be there. Now, this I frame has been given a name because, okay, the encoding of that frame will be done as a intra, this is called as the intra frame. Okay, so spatial compression, spatial domain compression is done, means JPEG compression is done on the I frame, whereas in P, in case of P frame, instead of doing the spatial domain compression, you estimate the motion vector, and only the difference, which is nothing but the motion, will be encoded. So that is nothing but the predicted frame. Okay, so P is called as the predicted frame, I is the intra. Intra means within. Okay, and then B is the B frame, that is bidirectional predicted frame. So either you can use previous or future. Okay, so there are three types of frames, but generally two types of frames are used, that is I frame and P frame. Okay, now P frame is sent, okay, after few I frames, maybe after three or four I frames, P frame is sent just to refresh the data. Okay, now see, in case of this video standard, compression standard, okay, these frames are sent like as a I frame, then P frame, P frame, P frame, and then again I frame, okay, I frame, to just refresh the data periodically. Okay, so we'll see that later on. Now, the compression in the time domain, suppose for example, the difference between the consecutive frame is often small. For example, here, this person is here, okay, whereas your rest of the objects are at same place. So if this person is moving, so most of the spatial domain information remains same. Only thing is that this person is moving from this place to this place here. Again, in third frame, it has moved. Rest of the data is same. Okay, so difference between the consecutive frame is often small. So if you take the difference between this one and this one, so there will be only difference between this part, rest of the part will be same. If you take the difference between this one and this one, so there will be only difference between this part, rest of the part will be same. So in consecutive frames, difference between consecutive frame is very, very small. Okay, and then if you detect that difference, that is nothing but detecting that difference is nothing but finding the motion vector. So encode only that part rather than encoding the whole image or whole frame. Okay. So there are, what are the different standards of video compression? So basically there are two types of standard. One is, okay, there are two families of standard. One is ISO, IEC, MPEG family, and another one is ITU-T family. Okay. So ISO is nothing but International Standardization Organization. Okay, or IEC is nothing but International Electrotechnical Commission. Okay, and MPEG is nothing but Moving Picture Expert Group. Okay, so this ISO IEC standard developed the MPEG standard for the image compression. Okay, and then ITU-T, okay, which has developed another video compression standard. Okay, application of this MPEG and video, this H-dot compression are different. See that. This is the development of MPEG-1, which was developed in 1992, video standard for CD-ROM and internet. But the video standard which was firstly developed, it was developed by ITU-T, okay, and it is called as H.dot standard. Okay, that is H.261, H.262, and so on. Actually, it came into existence in 1990s. Okay, committee was established in 1988, and after that, okay, the recommendation was given in 1992. And at the same time, another standard was also developed, that is MPEG standard, but the application of this MPEG is different and application of H.dot is different. Okay, so particularly H.261, 262, and so on, they are used for video conferencing. Okay, whereas MPEG-1 is used for, this is the standard for CD-ROM and internet video, whereas MPEG-2 is a standard for television and telecommunication. Okay, MPEG-4 is advanced video coding standard. Okay, MPEG-7, which was developed in 2001, okay, it is particularly for metadata, metadata for audio video stream, and that particularly in multimedia content based media retrieval. Okay, and MPEG-21, which was developed in 2002, it is the standard for distribution, exchange, user access of multimedia data and the intellectual property management. So these are the standards of MPEG. Okay, now in our syllabus we are going to study MPEG 1 and MPEG 2. Okay, and the another video standard that is that was developed by International Telecommunication Union (ITU-T). Okay, so this development was in 1992. First, they developed H.261, the first video codec specification, that is video codec for visual services at P star 64 kbps. Okay, P cross 64 kbps. That is also called as the P star standard. Okay, this is also called as the P star standard. Okay, H.262, which was developed in 1995, it is a standard for infrastructure of audiovisual services coding of moving video group. Okay, at the same time, H.263 was developed in 1995 as a video coding for low bit rate communication. Okay, now see that H.261 is having a bit rate of 64 kbps, whereas okay, this H.263 is the advanced version of H.261, but it is having low bit rate as compared to H.261. Okay, then H.264 it was developed in 2002. It was advanced video codec, that is AVC, in conjunction with MPEG-4. Now, if you look the development parallelly of ITU-T and ISO, okay, so in 1990s, okay, so actually this was developed, MPEG-1 was developed in 1993, whereas H.261 was developed in 1990s. Okay, means actually this ITU-T standard development was started before than ISO IEC standard. Okay, so this is video compression, this is video compression expert group, ITU-T, and then MPEG-2 and H.262 are jointly developed in 1994 by both the committee. Okay, then H.263 was independently developed by ITU-T, whereas MPEG-4, MPEG-4 version 2, MPEG-4 version 3 was developed in 1998 to 2001, and then H.263 plus and plus plus, and then finally again both committee developed H.264 and MPEG-4 in 2002. So this is the development of this standard. Okay, particularly this H. or T standard is used for video conferencing, and rest of this one, MPEG is used for CD-ROM internet, then it is used for television, then MPEG-7 is used for content-based image retrieval, and then MPEG-21. So application of this standard is different. Okay, now we'll start the H.261 first. Okay, so in our syllabus we'll study H.261 and H.263, okay, as this ITU-T standard, and in chapter number 11 we are going to study MPEG-1 and MPEG-2. Okay, so H.261 is an earlier standard, digital video compression standard. It is its principle of motion compensation based compression is retained in all the later video compression standard. Means motion compensation, this block will be there in, see now this is H.261. In H.263, the main difference between H.261 and 263 is that H.261 is having bit rate of 64 kbps, whereas H.263 is having a bit rate, lower bit rate than H.261. So H.263 is advanced version of H.261. So the basic block which are used in H.261 will be there in the H.263. Only modification is done so that bit rate can be reduced. Okay, so the standards was designed for video phone, that is video conferencing and other audio visual services over ISDN. Okay, the video codec supports bit rate of P cross 64 kbps, where P ranges from 1 to 30, also known as P star 64. Now, what is this P? Basically, 1 to 34 means basically 1 to 30, that is channels, number of channels. So, number of channels can be from 1 to 30. So, requires that the delay of video, this H.261, one requirement of H.261 is that the delay of video encoder be less than 150 milliseconds so that the video can be used for real-time bidirectional video conferencing. So this is the requirement of H.261. Now the file formats which are supported by H.261 is QCIF and CIF. Okay, so CIF is nothing but common intermediate format. Okay, and QCIF is quadrature common intermediate format. Okay, so see that, what is the size of this one? What is the size of each frame in CIF? 352 by 288. Now, if you divide, okay, this frame into four different parts, okay, so this is basically 352 into 288, okay. So, if you make it the division like this, this will be 176 by 144. So, this will be the frame size in case of QCIF. That is why it is called as the quadrature, common intermediate file formats. Okay. Whereas, this resolution, for convenience resolution, it is 88 by 72 for this one QCIF, and it is 176. Okay. And bit rate is 9.1, whereas this one is 36.1, and H.261, okay, support is required, whereas CIP is optional. Okay, so basically these file formats are used in H.261. Okay, now see that moving images contain significant temporal redundancy, so successive frames are very very similar. Okay, successive frame, if you take, these are very very similar. So instead of encoding each frame, okay, the frames coding is done as infra frame coding and inter frame coding. So video coding algorithm usually contains two schemes. One is intra frame coding and another one is inter frame coding. Means intra frame coding means JPEG, standard JPEG will be there, which will be coding this iframe, and then motion will be encoded by using inter frame coding. So if you join together, you'll get the MPEG. Means JPEG is an integral part of MPEG. One of the part of JPEG is nothing. One of the part of MPEG is nothing but JPEG. Or one of the part of H.261 is also JPEG. Okay. So see here, the intra-frame coding. Intra-frame coding does not exploit the correlation among the adjacent frames. Okay. Intra-frame coding therefore is similar to the still image coding. Means you are doing just the compression of one frame, that is iframe. Okay, so what kind of redundancy you are removing with that one? Spatial redundancy is removed with the intra-frame coding or still image coding. And then inter-frame coding is nothing but the inter-frame coding should include motion estimation or compensation process to remove the temporal redundancy. So in video coding or video compression we are removing two types of redundancy. One is spatial redundancy and another one is temporal redundancy. So spatial redundancy is done by intra frame coding and temporal redundancy is removed by using inter frame coding. Okay, so now see that this is the frame sequence in case of H.261. Okay, so this iframe is nothing but intra frame, then P frame is there, that is predictive frame, then P frame, and again iframe is there. So in between two iframes, how many P frames are there? Three P frames are there. Again iframe is sent, and again three P frames are sent. Okay, why iframe is sent? Okay, so just to refresh that data, okay, iframe is sent, okay, after few P frames. Okay, so this is the frame sequence in case of H.261. Okay, so two types of image frames are defined, that is intra frame iframe and inter frame, that is P frame. So iframes are treated as independent images, and transform coding method similar to the JPEG, okay, is applied within each iframe, that is the hence the term intra. So within that iframe, okay, this JPEG coding is done. Then P frames are not independent, they are dependent on either previous one or next one. So that's why it is called as the dependent. Whereas this iframe coding is done independently, Okay, so this is called as the independent frame. Okay, so P frames are independent, are not independent, coded by forward predictive coding method, or prediction from previous P frame is allowed, not just from the previous I frame. Okay, and then temporal redundancy removal is included in P frame coding, whereas I frame coding performs only spatial redundancy removal. Okay, now to avoid the propagation of coding errors, see why this I frame is sent after 3-4 P frame. To avoid the propagation coding errors, an I frame is usually sent a couple of times in each second of the video. Okay, so motion vectors in H.261 are always measured in the units of full pixel, and they have limited range of plus minus 15 pixel. That is, P is equal to 15, the size of search window will be equal to 31 by 31. Okay, so in this H.261, all those three techniques are used. Okay, now see that intra frame coding already we have studied in JPEG. Okay, so this if it is a color image, it will be converted into YCRCB, and then each 8x8 block you are going to take the DCT, then quantization, and then encoding. Okay, there will be before this, in encoding again there are two parts. One is initial level encoding, that is DPCM for DC and run length encoding for AC, and after that entropy based encoding will be done and you'll get the encoded image or compressed image. So this will be the block of this one. Now intra frame coding, okay, so macro blocks are of size 16 by pixel, okay, for Y frame, and 8 by 8 for CB and CR frames, since 4S2 chromosome assembly is employed, and macro block consists of 4Y, 1CB and CRCB. Okay, for each 8x8 block, okay, a DCT transform is applied, and the DCT coefficients go through the quantization of zigzag scan, and entropy coding will be done. Okay, now inter-frame coding. Okay, so in inter-frame coding, what we do? We divide the whole image into number of macro block, and the size of each macro block will be equal to 16 by 16, and then we sort, okay, the match between the macro block, okay, of target frame and the reference frame, and then from that we calculate the motion vector. So when motion vector will be there, basically the target pixel and the reference pixel, if it is matching, so difference will be 0, and then we assign that as a motion vector pixel. Okay, and after that again same thing will be done. First thing is that we are extracting the motion vector, and then again once you have got that motion vector, okay, each image will be encoded similar to the JPEG. Now see that interframe coding, for each macro block in the target frame, a motion vector is allocated by one of the search method discussed earlier, that is either you can use sequential search or logarithmic or hierarchical. Okay, after the prediction, a difference macro block is derived to measure the prediction error. Okay, now each of these 8x8, it's not 88, it is a each of these 8x8 block go through the DCT, quantization, zigzag scan, and entropy coding procedure. Okay, so it will be done like that way. Now, the P frame coding encodes different macro block, not as the target macro itself. Sometimes a good match cannot be found, that is, the prediction error exceeds a certain acceptable level. The macro block itself is then encoded, treated as an intra macro block. And in this case, it is termed as a non-motion compensated macro block. Okay. For motion vector, the difference MVD is sent for entropy coding. That is, motion vector difference is equal to MV preceding minus MV motion vector of current. Okay. Motion vector of previous minus motion vector of current. See that. Means, what we are doing here? What is the meaning of this last one? Suppose here, you have detected, okay, from intra frame and P frame, what you have detected? motion vector. Okay. Now from this frame and this frame, again what you are going to retake? Motion vector. Here again you are going to retake motion vector. Now instead of sending this motion vector, can we further increase the compression ratio? If you send the difference between this one and this one, okay, compression will be achieved again very high. Okay, so this motion vector difference, instead of sending motion vector difference will be sent to increase the compression. Okay, now see that the quantization in H.261 uses a constant step size. Okay, what was the quantization in case of this one JPEG? What was the quantization? How we were doing the quantization in case of JPEG? There was a standard quantization table, no? And then basically the quantization, if you see the entries of that quantization table, okay, the step size was less in the low frequency, whereas step size was larger in the high frequency. Okay, so that was there in case of JPEG. But in case of H.261, what is the difference between, see, that we are going to use for coding the I frame. But when you are coding, encoding the P frame, at that time the quantization which is used in H.261 uses the constant step size. Means whatever may be the frequency, step size is same. Whereas in earlier case JPEG, the step size of quantization was varied. Okay. So, the quantization in H.261 uses a constant step size for all DCT coefficient within a macro block. Okay. So, if we use DCT and QDCT to denote the DCT coefficient before and after the quantization, then DC coefficient in intra mode QDCT, you are going to round it by DCT divided by step size, which is equal to round DCT by 8. For all other coefficients, okay, this is for DC component basically, okay, and for all other coefficient, okay, DCT divided by step size will be 2 into scale. Means for DC it is fixed, and then for AC DCT coefficients, these are floor value of 2 into scale, okay. So scale is an integer range of 1 to 31, okay, so you can select any range between that one. Now, we'll see the encoder and decoder of H.261. How does this H.261 works? What do you think? What should be the block diagram of H.261 encoder? What should be the mechanism there in H.261? What we do basically in H.261? Number one, we remove the spatial redundancy and we remove the temporal redundancy. So for removing the spatial redundancy, which frame we are using? I-frame. So I-frame, how do you remove this spatial redundancy? By using simple JPEG. So we should give I-frame as an input to this standard JPEG block diagram. Okay. And then, how do you remove the temporal redundancy? First, we have to calculate the motion vector between I frame and P frame, and then once you have calculated the motion vector, again it will be sent as an input to the JPEG, standard JPEG. Means there should be a mechanism at the lower side which will find the motion vector, okay, and then it will be given as an input to the JPEG. So see that there are actually in the next slide we'll see the block diagram of H.261. Okay. Shows a relatively complete picture of how H.261 encoder and decoder work. Okay. A scenario is used where frames like I, P1, P2 are encoded and then decoded. Okay, decoded will be done in decoder. Okay, no, decoded frames, not the original frames, are used as reference frames in motion estimation. Okay. Then the data that goes through the observation points indicated by the circle number are summarized in this table. Okay. ठीक है. नाउ सपोज फॉर एग्जाम्पल हियर दिस इज द ब्लॉक डायग्राम ऑफ एच डॉट 261. सी इफ यू अंडरस्टूड दिस ब्लॉक डायग्राम करेक्टली देन इजिली यू कैन स्टडी द एच डॉट 263. दिस इज वेरी सिंपल. ओके नाउ सी दैट वॉट इज दिस पी वन. पी वन इज द ओरिजिनल इमेज. पी डैश इज द पी वन डैश इज द प्रेडिक्शन. ओके एंड पी वन टिल्ट इज द डिकोडेड इमेज. ओके पी वन टिल्ट इज द डिकोडेड इमेज. डी वन इज द प्रेडिक्शन एरर एंड डी वन टिल्ट इज द डिकोडेड प्रेडिक्शन एरर. ओके नाउ सी दैट इफ यू ओके सो हियर सर्कल्ड पॉइंट वन इज एट द टॉप लेफ्ट बिफोर समिंग पॉइंट. बिफोर समिंग पॉइंट देर इज अ पॉइंट नंबर वन. ओके हियर इट इज पॉइंट नंबर टू. इट इज हियर इट इज पॉइंट नंबर टू. पॉइंट नंबर थ्री इज द आउटपुट ऑफ समिंग पॉइंट और बेसिकली हियर इज अ डिफरेंस. ओके you are taking the difference between the 1 and suppose for example this is 2 so 1 minus 2 is nothing but 3. theek hai so 3 is the output of that one. then where is 4? 4 is here after IDCT inverse discrete cosine transform. and where is 5? 5 is here. 5 is here. where is 6? Here. Okay. Now output code you are you'll get the output code there. Okay. Now see the block diagram of this one. Okay. So you have two options. Okay. Now here this you have switch to switch from intra frame to inter frame. Okay. So it is time division multiplexing is used. TDM technique is used there. After that, what you are going to do? DCT. Okay. So this is the block of DCT. Then quantization. Okay. Then variable length encoding. Then buffer. And then you'll get the encoded output. So if you see the top part, what is this top part? This is nothing but the JPEG. Okay, now the bottom part is used for what? Motion estimation. Okay, motion vector estimation. For motion vector estimation, what you need? How do you need the? How do you do the motion vector estimation? You need a reference frame and you need the okay current frame. Okay, reference means previous or next one also. Okay, so for example, reference one is the previous one and the current one is this one, target frame. Okay, so you need this reference frame first. Okay, now initially, for example, which frame is there? I frame is there. What kind of compression you are going to do? Spatial. Okay, you are going to remove the spatial redundancy. So for example, if your switch is at the top position, okay, so current frame will be your I frame and that will be given to the DCT. Okay, so this will be divided into 8x8 non overlapping and then DCT will be taken, then quantization will be there, and then after that variable length encoding will be there, and then output will be given to the output buffer. Okay, now if there is a basically why this quantization control is there. So basically, if there is a lot of data at the output buffer, okay, at that time you have to increase the quantization step size. Okay, so depends upon the data at output buffer. Okay, if it is full, then you have to increase the size. So this feedback is given to the queue. See that feedback from the output buffer is given to the queue as well as queue inverse. Okay, so this quantization step will be change depends upon the data in the output buffer. So now here for the first frame, what you got? You got I frame encoded. Now the same iframe we want for what purpose? As a reference frame, because this is used, this frame is used as a reference frame, okay, whereas this frame is used as a target frame or current frame. Okay, so whenever next frame comes, we are in a need of this frame also, so that we can find out the motion vector by considering this frame and this frame. So to have this frame is already encoded first, and then again we are decoding by doing the inverse quantization and inverse DCT. Okay, so what do you got? You have got this output at 4, which is nothing but the reconstructed image, and at that time this switch position will be here, so you are giving input as a 0. So 4 plus 0, what you are going to, this 5 will be having 0 output, and this 4, so in reconstructed image will be at 6, and then that will be stored in a frame memory, okay, for what purpose? Which will be used as a reference frame for the next predict P frame. Got it? Now see that when we have considered the first iframe, it has gone through the JPEG compression, same frame, okay, after compression it has been reconstructed and it has been stored in a frame memory in this one. Okay, now when next frame comes, at that time your upper switch will be at the down position, that is inter frame. Okay, this switch will be also, this switch will be at inter frame. Now see that whenever next frame comes, that P frames, then motion estimation will be evoked. So here you have directly the P frame, and here you have earlier I frame. So by using P frame and I frame, you can calculate the motion vector, and then motion vector will be this, you'll get the motion vector output, which will be connected to the this one, input to the difference, and then it will be again encoded in the same way, again it will come to this one. Okay, so this difference will be added to your, see that this difference, what is the prediction, will be added to that, and then second frame will be stored. Okay, so like that way, whenever third or second P frames comes, what will be there, your first P frame will be acting as a reference one, and the next P frame will be acting as a current frame, and then motion vector will be detected, and again it will be encoded, and so on. So like that way it works. See that, okay, this is the decoder. Okay, see, this is the data flow point observation, that is I. Okay, when I comes, okay, I will be there at point one, and then I bar will be, or I tilt will be at point 4, that is reconstructed thing, and 5 at that time it will be 0. So 5 plus 4 is nothing but your 6, that is nothing but the reconstructed I frame. When P1 frames comes, at point number 1 it is P1, at point number 2 it is a predicted or basically motion, and at point number 3 this is nothing but the difference between the P1 and P1 dash, and then at point number 4 it is reconstructed difference, and then at point number 5 it will be P1 dash, because this is given as the input to this point. And what is this 6? 6 is nothing but addition of 5 and 4, so this is nothing but the reconstructed P1. Okay, so it is the same thing, only thing is that now here P2 is there, so at 1 P2, P2 dash, D2, D2 dash, P2 dash, and P2 tilt. So these are the frame sequence, or basically frames at the various point of encoder of H.261. Okay, so if you go back, do you have any doubt here? How does this work? Okay, so So basically, iframe will be encoded by using JPEG and P frames for P frame only. Okay, this part will be evoked. Okay, this whenever P frames comes. Okay, so this will evoke the motion estimation, and then motion estimation will be calculated here. So prediction frame will be done here. That will be used as one of the input to this one, and then 3 will be P 1 minus 2, and then again same thing will be encoded by JPEG. Only thing is that motion estimation will be done like this. And for motion estimation, what we need to reconstruct the previous frame. So this vertical portion is used for reconstruction of the previous frame, and then that will be stored in frame memory, okay, as a reference one. Okay, and then it will be done like this. Okay, now this H.261 decoder, okay, H.261 decoder will work exactly opposite to encoder. Okay, so input will be your code, okay, or compressed image, then this one input buffer, then variable length encoding, then inverse quantization, inverse DCT, and then so basically this part is similar to the lower part of your encoder, okay, and then you'll get the decoded frame. Okay, so I hope that you got same thing. Okay, now see, these are the current frame and observation point data flow of H.261. okay, so much this will be done. Sorry. Okay, now what is the syntax of H.261 bitstream? Okay, now if you look at the syntax of H.261, okay, now when, what is the last level this one representation of the image, or in case of compression, what do? You divide the image into how many? Basically, in case of DCT, in case of JPEG, what do you do? Divide the image into number of blocks. What is the size of block? 8 by 8. Now, each 8 by 8 block contains what? See, after this one, taking the DCT, it contains 1 DC component and 63 AC component. Means, what we can say that each 8 by 8 block contains DC component and AC component, and then such a, okay, basically whole image is divided into 8 by 8 blocks. So image contains blocks, block contains DC and AC component. Okay, now in case of H.261, this is not only one frame, there are nothing but the, there are several frames now. So how this bitstream, video bitstream, is having a syntax? Okay, so basically next figure will give you the syntax of H.261 bitstream. Okay, hierarchy of 4 layer, that is picture layer, group of block, macro block, and block. See that picture level means, what is that? Number of frames per second. After picture level, when you come to the local level, what will be there? It will be one picture. Again, in one picture, what will be there? There will be blocks. So it will be a group of blocks. In each group of block, then again there will be a macro block and blocks more. Okay, so the picture layer, which contains picture start code, delineates the boundaries between the picture, that is temporal reference, provides the timestamp for the picture. Okay, then group of block layer, in H.261, pictures are divided into a regions of 11 by 3 macro block, each of which is called as the group of block. Okay, and this next figure depicts the arrangement of group of blocks in a CIF or QCIF luminance image. Okay, for instance, the CIF image has 2 × 6 group of blocks corresponding to its image resolution of 352 by 288 pixels. Each group of block is having its own start code, that is group of block start code and group number. In case of network error causes a bit error or the loss of some bit, the H.261 video can be recovered and resynchronized at the next identifiable group of block. Okay, the macro block layer, Each macro block has its own address indicating its position within the group of block quantizer, that is M quantization, and each and 6 8x8 image blocks. Okay, and the block layer, each 8x8 block, the bitstream starts with DC value followed by the pairs of length of run length and its subsequent non-zero value levels for AC, and finally end of block means this one. Actually, your encoding of a still image. Okay, so label reflects the quantization value and its ranges from -127 to +127. Okay, so this is the video bitstream syntax of a, so H.261 picture frame. So PSC, that is picture layer. Okay, that is picture start code. Then TR is nothing but the temporal reference. P type is nothing but the picture type, and then this each picture frame contains group of block. Now if you consider the simple group of block layer, so it will be having the different things like as a group block start code, group number, then G quant, that is group of block quantizer, then macro block. So group of block consists of contains a macro block. Then each macro block, if you go, so it will contain a address type. Okay, then M quantizer, macro block quantizer, then motion vector difference, then CBP, that is coded block pattern, then B0, B1 up to like that, that is blocks. Okay, and each block contains the DC value and then AC value and end up. So this is the standard basically bitstream in case of H.261. Okay, so in that way this video coding is done by using H.261. Okay, now H.263 we'll see in tomorrow's lecture. Okay, I hope that you have understood H.261. Okay, it's simple, just read that one in the from the book. Okay, JPEG coding and motion vector estimation, and then both the things are again encoded by using standard JPEG. Okay, so this is the block diagram. Same block diagram is used in the H.263. Okay, only thing is that the sampling is different. Okay, so that we'll see tomorrow. Okay, and also we'll start the, because this is a small part which is left from this chapter. Okay, that is H.263. And we'll see the exact difference between H.261 and 263. Okay, rest of the part is similar to the H.261, and then we'll start the MPEG 1 and MPEG 2. Okay, so we'll stop here. Thank you.